Thank you. Encyclopedia, oh Lydia, the queen of tattoo. On her back is the battle of Waterloo. Beside it, the wreck of the Hesperus, too. And proudly above waves the red, white, and blue. You can learn a lot from Lydia. When a robe is unfurled, she will show you the world. If you step up and tell her where. For a dime you can see Kankakee or Paris or Washington crossing the Delaware. Oh, Lydia, oh, Lydia, say, have you met Lydia? Lydia, the tattoo lady. So start relaxing. Up the hill comes Andrew Jackson. Lydia, oh Lydia, the encyclopedia. Oh Lydia, the queen of them all. For 2 bits she will do a mazurka in jazz, with a view of Niagara that nobody has. And on a clear day you can see Alcatraz. You can learn a lot from Lydia. Come along and see Buffalo Bill with his lasso. Just a little classic by Mendel Picasso. Here is Captain Spaulding exploring the Amazon. Here's Godiva, but with her pajamas on. Here is Grover Whalen unveiling the Trilon. Over on the west coast we have Treasure Island. Here's Nijinsky doing the rumba. Here's her social security number. She once swept an admiral clear off his feet. The ships on her hips made his heart skip a beat. And now the old boy's in command of the fleet. For he went and married Lydia. I said Lydia.
He said Lydia.
I said Lydia.
We said Lydia.
Going to bring out Senorita Josephine, the greatest of all the snake trainers. Senorita Josephine, and what she's wearing around her neck is a baby boa constrictor. I say a baby because, ladies and gentlemen, the snake that she's wearing around her neck is only a baby in size. However, this afternoon you'll see the Senorita exhibit large snakes, some as long as 20 feet in length, and big around as a human's body. The Senorita Josephine exhibit all non-poisonous snakes, and they come from the constriction family, where they kill their prey by crushing the object to death. However, Senorita Josephine did not have this snake under perfect control at all times. It would do her bodily harm in less time than it would take for me to tell you. Senorita Josephine is just one of the 16 big acts of the 33 people that Ringling Brothers and Barnum & Bailey's combined big circus sideshow are presenting here this afternoon. Ladies and gentlemen, we feel that our show is large, and our show is self-explanatory. We ask you to look at the pictorial pictures on each side of that center doorway. Read the names above the pictures and the captions below. It tells you who these people are and what they do with the greatest sideshow on earth. But just a minute, there's one person I want to bring to your attention, and that is Johan Pettersson, that Viking giant from Iceland. Why, he stands and towers above all mankind. He stands 8 feet, 8 inches tall, weighs 425 pounds, and with outstretched arms measuring from fingertip to fingertip, 109 inches. He is the tallest man on the face of the earth. And today, our theme is the tallest man in the world, the smallest and tiniest person on the face of the earth, the fattest of all fat people, and the thinnest man alive. Yes, it's Ringling Brothers and Barnum & Bailey's combined big circus sideshow. And it is in here where you'll see the freaks, the wonders, the strange, the unusual people. All in all, there are 16 big acts, 33 of the strangest people on the face of the earth. And they're all alive. They're all living on public exhibition here today. Would you check your watches, please? It is now 12:30. The circus in the main tent will start on time as usual at 2:15. You have 1 hour and 45 minutes before anything takes place in the main tent. 45 minutes before the big show doors even open, you can see the sideshow in just 15 minutes in its entirety. And ladies and gentlemen, you can see the sideshow today. It is the biggest, the grandest, the greatest sideshow on the face of the earth, traveling with the largest circus in all the world. It's Ringling Brothers and Barnum and Bailey's combined big circus sideshow. More freaks, wonders, strange and unusual people than any other traveling museum, circus, or sideshow in the entire world. The price to see the sideshow? One ticket, 16 big acts, 33 people, 50 cents a half a dollar. Get tickets to me now.
Neola, the featured attraction of this midway, was brought here during the Great Evolution Trial that took place in Dayton, Tennessee in 1925. She was studied upon by some of our leading psychiatrists. Dr. Mullen, head of the Department of Psychiatry, studied upon her, claimed she had less intelligence, less brains than that of a chimpanzee. But let me paint you a word picture of her, just as you're going to see her in there tonight. She stands about 3.5 feet tall, with long arms that hang way down below the knees, eyes that pop out in glare just like two red-hot coals of fire. But the most peculiar thing of all that I think, and I think you'll agree with me, is the shape of the head. The head tapers at the top, just like that of a coconut. Now, she doesn't speak any language, doesn't know any creed, neither walks nor talks, just creeps and crawls. And she spends her lifetime down in that steel-bound cage, down in there now where you would not expect a dog to live for an hour. She was found by a Dr. Carter and leased to us by the Smithsonian Institution of Washington, D.C. Dr. Carter heard the strange tale of some fanatic natives in the center of a deep, dark cave who claimed they had found an animal. In investigating their story, he found it to be fact, but he found not an animal, but a human being, crouched, as you're going to see her tonight, upon a huge flat rock. From a point of vantage, he watched her. She was entirely surrounded by venomous reptiles, some larger than a man's upper arm. And occasionally she would tease, tantalize, and torment them until in their wildest of fury they'd strike, biting her all over her miserable body. Upon the arms, the limbs, the cheeks, even upon the tongue, until the blood would course from those wounds just like it'd pour water from a glass. Often to avenge herself, she'd pick up one of the larger reptiles, bite off the head with her long and tusky teeth, and proceed to peel down the skin and devour it, head high, tail and all, just as you or I would eat a banana. Now, all afternoon, they've been asking, when and what time are you going to feed her? Ladies and gentlemen, I'm happy to announce that that time has indeed now arrived. Once on exhibition, in fact, on this very performance, I'm going to feed her exactly as you would see her in her own native land, Abyssinia, in the north of Africa. On this very performance, I'm going to throw deep, deep into that steel-bound enclosure that live chicken you see me there now holding. You're going to then see a most amazing change come over the old woman. The eyes will dilate, the pupils glow just like two red-hot coals of fire. She will emit one long, soul-searing scream, leap clear across that steel arena, catch that bird between those two massive jaws, bite off the head with those long and tusky teeth, and ladies and gentlemen, proceed to devour and suck every drop of blood from that bleeding, throbbing, quivering, pulsating body with the very same relish that you or I would suck the juice of an orange. It's one of the most disgusting, one of the most repulsive, and yet I'll say one of the most interesting sights you've ever seen in all your life. Now, friends, it's way, way past feeding time. I just want to say one thing. If you go in there tonight and you fail to see her exactly as I've represented, in every way, every shape, every form and every manner, then I'll beg with you, plead with you. In fact, I'll implore you to come back here to the pay box, and I'll refund your money just as cheerfully as I've taken it from you. Now, we're going to feed her within the next 3 minutes. The price of admission is usually a quarter. And I think it was Holmes that said, backward, turn backward, time and thy flight. Make me a child again, just for tonight. That's what I'm going to do for the next 3 minutes, and 3 minutes only. If you can lay as much as the price of a children's ticket upon that pay box, that's 10 cents. Everyone goes on a child's ticket. Hold it just a minute, doctor. Don't feed her. And we'll feed her within the next 3 minutes, whether one of you go, all of you go, or none of you go. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Ladies and gentlemen, we have just received a wire from the Smithsonian Institution at Washington, D.C. Neola must be back by the 25th of this month for scientific study and research. we've treated her like we would with our own daughter. And they claim they want her for scientific study and research, and they don't. They want to cut her up and dissect her and find out why she doesn't die from the bites of those many reptiles. But I cry out like the good minister of the gospel, and I say, don't kill her, but rather send her back. Send her back to the jungle that she loved and roamed those many years ago, back where the owls hoot and scream and await her arrival. And who knows, ladies and gentlemen, but what perhaps tonight, this very night, that some poor, dear old mother is searching, searching, searching through that hideous, screaming, impenetrable jungle night for that poor, unfortunate offspring in there now, just as you'd see her in her own native land, a live, living, genuine old human freak of nature, born to live just like you or I, actually degenerated until she's just as low, I'll say, just as primitive as the most primitive beast of the jungle. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Clifton Comedy Company. We've come to your city to stay 1 week, bringing you clean, moral, refined entertainment, which is absolutely free. We bring with us a company of 14 performers, each and every one an artist in his or her line. But more than that, they are all ladies and gentlemen and can conduct themselves as such. You can come down here every night with just as much impunity, just as much propriety as you'd go to church, that is, if you do go to church, because there'll be nothing seen, heard, said, or done that will mar the impunity or injure the propriety in any way, shape, form, or manner of the most fastidious little lady in the community. Now, we were sent here by the Finley Medicine Company of 4151 Olive Street, St. Louis, Missouri, for the express purpose of introducing and advertising their product. We have just two products. That's the hospital tonic and the instant liniment. Now, the hospital tonic is a harmless preparation consisting of roots, herbs, leaves, gums, barks, berries, and blossoms, including ginseng root, Diana Emma leaves, cinco, sulfamedda berries, iron phosphate, cajun, mandrake, Canadian snake root, bitter apple, Chinese dragon flower, and jimico oil. Let me briefly paint just a little word picture for you. People come in my office and they say, I haven't taken a dose of medicine in 5 years or 10 years. They're proud of it, very pleased, brag about it. Now, I paint you this picture, and I think even the smallest boy and girl in the audience can understand it. Those of you that keep house, you have sitting at your back door what we call a slop bucket or a garbage can. When you get through with breakfast dishes, you scrape it in here. You do the same with lunch, the same with dinner. When it gets full, empty it, bury it, feed it to the pigs. I don't care what you do, but just keep that bucket in that capacity for 1 week's time. Then I want you to see the condition. I want you to see the filth that adheres to the side, smell the stench that comes from it. Stop and think, I've been putting that same food into my stomach, not for a day, a week, a month, or a year, but for 5 years or 10 years, and I've never cleaned it out. And I will guarantee, ladies and gentlemen, as repulsive as this might sound, that the very first dose will bring from your body double handfuls of filth, slime, mucus, corruption, fecal matter, maggots, and even worms. Now, not long ago, we asked the Finley Company to add one more ingredient to that tonic, something that would pass a tapeworm, head and all. And friends, I'm proud to say that that condition now exists. I have some specimens right back there in my office. One I recall is from a Mr. Adams in Sanger, Texas, a brakeman on the Baltimore-Ohio Railroad. He came down on Monday night and got a bottle of that medicine. On Friday, he came down with one of those in a tin can. He said, my God, Doc, what's this? And I washed it and measured it. It's a tapeworm that measured almost 16 feet. And I have Mr. Adams' sworn statement in my trunk that he used no other medicine but the hospital tonic in the passing of that worm. Now, there's just one thing more, and then I'm all through. One thing that I think makes that product stand head and shoulders above anything else ever offered on the market. But I can't say much about it before a mixed audience of ladies and gentlemen. But I will say this. If there's a man within the hearing of my voice that goes to his home tonight, and he sees that poor wife, sister, mother, sitting there with her head tied up,